Well, I want to thank everybody for coming today. Most specifically, I want to thank our veterans. And a round of applause and a salute to all of you. I'll be as brief as I possibly can, and then I'm going to introduce my fellow senators. I see Senator Zeldin and Senator Larkin, both who served this great country of ours. I want to thank you both for being here with me. Thank you. Everybody knows that this year that this is a very tough budget process, a very tough budget cycle. And there's no doubt that it's really going to become a budget of not necessarily needs, but one of things that we're just going to have to do without. And we all get that. But you cannot balance the state budget on the backs of America's heroes. Our veterans in this state are the greatest treasure of America and of this state. And we're going to talk specifically about several issues. But we have veterans homes in New York State that right now are taking extraordinary cuts. And those cuts are going to force veterans who are at the end of a great life well lived. And to force them out of those homes and into non-state veterans homes, or worse, is simply unconscionable. Senator Larkin, Senator Zeldin, myself, the entire conference, and other senators on both sides of the aisle and in the assembly, we're working to restore that funding. That has got to be done today, and veterans from around this state the governor's proposed cuts to our veterans' homes, homes that have over 90% capacity, are not only simply unconscionable, they represent cruel and unusual punishment to the best of America and the best in New York State. And beyond being morally reprehensible, they are fiscally irresponsible, because the federal government that refunds and restores this program and replenishes the state coffers is extremely generous. And we actually will lose money by cutting these programs and unfortunately possibly shutting down some of these homes. I'm going to introduce a few individuals. Number one, I'll introduce Senator Larkin and Senator Zeldin to speak. Also, Ed Gettler, served in Korea, right? Ed was a Korean War vet. He is a Korean War vet. And he'll tell you a story where he was used basically as an atomic guinea pig by our government. Now, as we stand here today, we can think that these issues are old. No offense, Senator Larkin.
You noticed you looked at me, right?
You
got one more guy coming.
These issues are as present today as ever, and I'll tell you why. As we stand here today, there are American servicemen who are exposed to radiological contamination in Japan on a humanity mission. Those individuals are going to live with that for the rest of their life. Ed Gettler will tell you a story today that'll take your hair back. But know that it's not just the Ed Gettlers of World War II and the Korean War. It goes beyond that, and it goes until this very day. And this is why, as tough as this economic crisis may be, we cannot balance this budget on their backs. Number two, I'm going to introduce Matt Bonomo, right?
Yes,
Matt just returned from?
Iraq.
Matt just returned from Iraq. And I want Matt to tell you a story about how it feels like to be a returning vet, to have put your life and your limb on the line for this great country. He was proud to do it, no doubt about it. I'm sure he would go back in a moment's notice if he was ever needed. I'm sure his uniform is ready and crisp. But this nation made a promise to guys like Matt, to Senator Larkin, when he first raised his right hand and said that if you raise your right hand and you're willing to fight and die for this great country, that we will make a promise to you and we will take care of you. And I want you to listen to Matt and understand, while that promise, even though maybe it's in the law, is not being met, because he was actually looking for services on Google, went on Google to find services that really we should have been beating down his door to explain the services that are out here for him. Number two, Fred Skanga. Are you here, Fred? Fred's from Stony Brook Vet Homes. He's going to speak specifically about the veteran home closures that I was speaking about. And then Matt Tully behind me. Matt, we have a program in New York State that literally lumps our veterans in categories with convicted felons and other categories. We have a great federal program that has a set-aside for our disabled vets. But if you're a disabled vet, we're going to give a certain percentage of projects to you, just like we extend those opportunities to small businesses owned by women and minorities. We do the same at the federal level for our disabled vets. In this state, we're not doing that. We've got to get our act together and do that. So I'm going to let them speak after Senator Larkin and Senator Lee Zeldin. Senator Larkin? No? Okay.
Beauty before age.
Okay. Senator Lee Zeldin.
Well, thank you, everybody. My name is Lee Zeldin. I represent the 3rd Senate District down in Suffolk County. I'm glad that Fred Skang is here to speak on behalf of the Stony Brook Veterans Home. It is unfortunate that parts of this budget scrape it at bone, especially with this veterans issue. And, you know, Senator Ball, with his leadership here with this committee and in the Senate, we're doing everything that we can to fight for what's right on behalf of New York State veterans. I'm proud to be sponsoring legislation called the Specialist Thomas Woolworth Military Dignity Act. Senator Griffo has a bill as well today, as we send an important message to all those Gold Star families across the state of New York and those that may be, unfortunately, one day a future Gold Star parent, that we're fighting for you in advance. And if that time does unfortunately come, we'll make sure that your son, your daughter, is buried with dignity. And that's all we could do. And I sleep well at night knowing that this committee is doing everything that it can to fight for New York State veterans under the leadership of Senator Ball. I appreciate your invitation here. I'm overwhelmed by the great turnout of all the veterans. And I guess I'll make a pitch for one other thing, is the backlog of disability claims across New York State and across this country is too much. The process that has to be gone through really needs to be fixed. A lot of this falls under our federal government, but I do ask for our state, and I've spoken to Senator Ball about this, and he's brought it up at committee meetings. The VSOs that help staff these VA facilities to help with the disability backlog, we need to support them to the best extent we can, considering the economy. But I appreciate Senator Ball's advocacy on behalf of the VSOs and the VA centers. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Senator Ball. You know, we old-timers look at some of you young guys and say, you're the future. I remember when Carl first came here, you didn't have a beard. You looked slim and trim. And now he's still here. You know, too many people pass us by as veterans. Yesterday, I was in a St. Pat's Day parade, and I think it was one of the best in years. The crowd was great. They were waving flags. The number of veterans you saw there, we were speaking with one voice. We're not Marines, we're not soldiers, we're not sailors, we're not Coast Guard, we're not Air Force. We are veterans of the United States Armed Forces. Yeah. And I'm very proud to serve on this committee with Senator Ball, because you know, he also was told by the leader, you pick the members of our committee. And when he called me and said, Bill, I want you on the committee. You know, I had this committee back in Iraq One, and I don't like looking over anybody's shoulder. But when he asked me, I felt very proud, because he had one thing in common. We want to do what is right for our veterans. When you see those claims that are there, you know, you have to understand, you hear it more than we do. The Cortland case that's there, you know, we were told by the feds they were going to take care of it. Senator Ball's committee will take care of it. You guarantee you he will. So every one of us have a day coming that we don't know. But those of you who have been in combat know. Somebody you served with, someone you cherished, their friendship, have been called. And don't forget, you're speaking for them. The things that we need. Senator Ball said, it's a tough budget and all that. Well, when we had to go, nobody said, you know, well, don't go too far. Don't get wounded. Above all, don't get killed. Why should the veterans suffer when they gave so much for so many? Thank you very much.
And also walked in is the Assembly Ranker on Veterans Affairs, Assemblyman Bob Castelli, and an Army veteran as well. Bob.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Senator Ball. Thank you all, ladies and gentlemen, for coming here today. As the grandson of a World War I veteran, the son of a World War II veteran, a combat veteran of Vietnam, a disabled veteran, and the father of a veteran who just did 5 tours in Afghanistan, I understand that every generation sends the best and the brightest off to defend the ideals that we stand for. Once upon a time, many of us, those who came back from Vietnam, were greeted with less than a great deal of joy and thanks. The other day at Columbia University, by the way, a Iraqi war vet who was wounded 11 times got up to speak in a town hall meeting and was shouted down and heckled. I thought that that had died with my generation and it was over finally, but it has reared its ugly head again. That is not the welcome home that our veterans deserve. Never again. Never again should we see the disgraceful treatment that was witnessed the other day. And by the way, I wrote a letter to the President of Colombia outraged about that, and he did not deign to respond to that as yet. But I am hoping that he will finally wake up and do so. You don't have to honor the war, ladies and gentlemen, to honor the warriors. These young men, and now young women, give the best of what they have, and sometimes all they have, and make the supreme sacrifice for who we are. We owe them a debt of gratitude that is not repayable in this lifetime. But at the very least, we can take care of their wounds, both physical and mental, and allow them to transition back to a society that they served and risked their life for. As the ranking member of Veterans Affairs on the Assembly, I'm honored to work with Senator Larkin, Senator Ball, to make sure our returning veterans get what they deserve, starting with thank you and welcome home.
Okay, very good. I'll introduce right now Matt Bonomo, Iraq vet.
Thank you. Thank you. Senator Ball, Senate, Assemblymen, Congress, ladies, gentlemen, and esteemed guests. My name is Matteo Bonomo. I'm sorry. First, I want to say I'm extremely happy and proud to serve in the United States Army, and I feel like it was the best decision that I've ever made in my entire life.
Can't hear you there saying that in the rear.
Sorry about that. No, I said that I'm extremely proud for serving in the United States military, and it was the best decision of my entire life. Thank you all for coming out here and listening to what I have to say and what everybody else has to say. When I first got out of the military, it was kind of tough. It was hard just for the simple fact that I didn't have anybody to help me out with finding services, you know, as far as, you know, veterans and the VA goes. So me and my family and my close friends, we all decided to go online and, like, start doing the research on our own. I Googled up the Medicare system. I Googled up the school system, the post-9/11 GI Bill, and many other things. And I personally feel like there should have been somebody to help me out as far as, you know, committee-wise or veteran-wise, like the VA hospital. I didn't know that we had a VA hospital in New York. And now to come to know that we have 3. We have one in, I believe, in Brooklyn or Bronx. We have one in Manhattan, and we have one in the Long Island area. I enrolled myself in the one in the Manhattan area on 23rd Street between 1st and 2nd. And once I got there, that's when I actually started realizing what's good for me, what I'm able to do, and that, as far as college goes. Right now I attend Berklee College. I am the student body vice president, and I'm always constantly involved with whatever they do. And I'm completely proud to say that I am a student of theirs. As far as communication goes, when I did my out process in the United States military, they rushed everything. Once you get in, they try to detail everything, they keep you there for a long time, but when they try to get you out, they try to get you out. And I had to learn pretty much nothing. The only thing I learned was how to go into a job interview and that you only get like maybe a month or two of like Medicare. I'm like, wow. And just the other day, actually, if I may, just the other day, you know, I work as a security guard, and I have, like, these veterans that come in, many of these veterans, you know, the age of you, young, fine individuals, and they don't even know what they're entitled to. They don't even know what they deserve. So I pretty much sent them all, I sent everybody, I gave them the address, I told them to go to the city, to the VA hospital and get yourself a VA card, and like that, they could, you know, give you a hand and help you out with everything that you need to help be helped with. About a couple days later, they came by and they all thanked me. So with that all said, we need to have constant communication. There needs to be communication between the guys and those people that are coming out. And that's pretty much it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ed? Yep. My favorite atomic vet, Ed Gettler.
Good morning, everyone. I'm very proud to be here today. My name is Ed Gettler, and I am an atomic veteran. A life member of the National Association of Atomic Veterans and a member of the Putnam County Joint Veterans Council. We are the veterans, while in service to our country, that were exposed on purpose to ionizing radiation during the atomic and nuclear testing that occurred during the Cold War and starting from the necessary testing in Nevada in 1945 that resulted in the fall of Japan. The National Association of Atomic Veterans motto is, "No amount of ionizing radiation is healthy. It is considered a slow killer." In my experience, the words atomic veteran raises a question in the minds of most of the citizens of this grand state, and to be more correct, that same question arises in the mind of a very large percentage of the population of our country. What is an atomic veteran? The reason that question is asked today by both military personnel and our citizens is because the operations the military conducted during the Cold War nuclear testing period were deemed top secret. And this remained as such until the status was lifted in 1996, 51 long years after the testing began. And disclosing any information could result in serious consequences to any service personnel. It is no wonder that we are the unknown veterans. My short story begins after I enlisted in the United States Navy in February 1952. After 13 weeks in boot camp in San Diego, California, I reported to the USS Curtis, AV-4. Her home port was North Island, a short launch trip from downtown San Diego. After a few shakedown cruises to determine crew and ship readiness for the voyage to the Marshall Islands, the Curtis and her crew set sail in September 1952. We would be completing our mission within 3 months. Our top secret mission was called Operation Ivy. Upon arrival, we took an anchor station offshore from the test island in the Marshall Island chain. From our anchorage, we enjoyed a few swim parties after a launch ride to another mini island close by. Several earlier tests had been conducted in this area, unbeknownst to us. We were there for the duration anyway, but know this, nuclear contamination in our environment, land, sea, or air, has a half-life of 7,000 years. Our crew shuttled the scientists and the technicians who would be building the 10.2 megaton hydrogen bomb for testing on our test island. Another point of information, 1 megaton is equivalent to 1 million tons of TNT. That's a big package. The code name for this portion of operation was called Shot Mike. Later we learned there was another aerial test in the same area, unbeknownst, we don't know where it was. The day of the shot, just weeks before Christmas, 1952, all hands were piped to quarters on deck. We were instructed to face the port side, turn down your white hats, turn up your collar, roll down your sleeves, and close your eyes. As the countdown reached zero, we felt a blast of heat, a strong gush of hot air, and heard a tremendous roar, unlike anything I'd ever experienced in my life. After a short period of time, we were told we could turn around to look. At first, I thought, what's the big deal? Then I realized that there were two suns in the sky, one of which was growing a dark, ominous tail of smoke as it climbed upward. As that sun slowly hid in the rising column of smoke, I was looking straight up at its peak. Shortly afterwards, turn two was sounded, and we returned to our workstation to resume our daily routines. A few shipmates admitted peeking, and they said they looked at the hand of the man in front of them and saw the bones through his flesh. Not much more than a half hour later, the alarm sounded. General quarters, general quarters. All hands, man your battle stations. This is a drill. It does become quite obvious to any veteran that has any sense about what goes on that the purpose of this Operation Ivy Shot Mike was to determine for those that needed to know whether or not our crew would be able to function well enough to repel the enemy in the event of a real-life attack and exposure to nuclear radiation of such magnitude at a location within sight of the huge blast. Thus, we earned the name of guinea pigs. It is my personal opinion that the huge test in which we participated was highly influential in the signing of the Korean War ceasefire within a few short months of the largest test of its kind to that day. To date, after the top secret classification was lifted, a few brave among our representatives have stepped up to introduce a bill to honor and recognize the atomic veterans with a medal that would be equivalent to, but not the same as, a Purple Heart. However, their efforts fell on deaf or non-veteran ears, and the bills never went anywhere. Currently, there is a bill and a resolution before the New York State Legislature recognizing the atomic veterans of New York State, drafted and presented by Senator Greg Ball. Thank you very much. If approved, these would make New York State the forerunner in our nation in our struggle for just recognition. I sincerely hope that my short story or a similar one will eventually reach all the American citizens so that after noticing my colors, the question that may have been asked me, what is an atomic veteran, will have been answered up front. And at some time, while less than half of us still live, we receive the just recognition that we have earned and so deserve. On behalf of all the American atomic veterans, I pray that God blesses and protects America and all of her faithful and loyal citizens and warriors. Amen. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, Ed.
Thank you, sir.
Should we, you want to go next?
Sure.
Okay, very good. Okay. Frank Skagnon, he's from Stony Brook Vet Homes, and this speaks specifically to the closure and the extreme cut in the funding for New York State Veterans Homes and that program. Thanks, Frank.
Thanks, sir. Thank you, Senator Ball. I'm Fred Skagnon, the Executive Director of the Long Island State Veterans Home at Stony Brook University and the first Vice President of the National Association of State Veterans Homes. I'm grateful, Senator Ball, for the opportunity to speak and educate our legislators, and I'm also grateful to Senators Larkin, Zeldin, Golden, who are here, and our guardian angel in Suffolk County, Senator John Flanagan. Also, I'd like to acknowledge Assemblyman Castelli for all his great work on behalf of State Veterans Homes. The State Veterans Home Program is the oldest partnership between federal government and state government in the history of American government, founded by Abraham Lincoln after the Civil War. Currently, we have 5 great state veterans homes here in New York State: Stony Brook, Montrose, St. Albans, Queens, Batavia, and Oxford, New York. Right now, there are 1,220 beds, and I'm here to say that New York State right now, for its 1 million veterans, is already underbedded, but the governor is proposing through his cuts to reduce our workforce by 10%, thereby we would have to eliminate 260 beds from the system. Right now, we're giving great quality of care, and more important, great quality of life to a very special generation of veterans, everyone from the greatest generation to the latest generation. Last year, we provided over 427,000 days of care, and we enabled veterans to seek out and receive both their benefits and their entitlements. Things like the VA per diem grant program, which gives veterans extra funding for their care, but only if they stay at a state veterans home. Things like full cost of care coverage, protecting those veterans who are 70% or more service-connected disabled. They receive free cost of care, completely paid for by President Obama and Congress, but only at a state veterans home. And last but not least, the aides in attendance pension, where if you qualify for that, a veteran in a state veterans home will receive $685 per month for the care of his spouse or his kids. But if he gets transferred to a non-state veterans home, that would be dramatically reduced to $90 a month. State veterans homes are not a burden. We consider them an asset to the state of New York. Senator Ball, I want you to know that every day at the Long Island State Veterans Home, we are caring for atomic vets like Ed Gettler and like Iraqi vets like Matteo Bonomo. Let's not balance the budget on the backs of America's heroes. Let's protect the State Veterans Home program in New York State. Thank you.
Okay, Matt Tully will speak on the plight of our disabled vets and those returning, and then we'll open it up to questions. Matt.
Thank you, Senator. My name is Matt Tully. I'm an attorney who 8 years ago started my law firm around my kitchen table. In those 8 years, it's turned into a multi-million-dollar operation spanning the world. And we faced a great deal of adversary nature here in New York. The bill that the senator has sponsored will allow, not necessarily me, because we have grown out of the program, but other veterans behind me to have preference in state government contracts. Right now, 1 in 5 veterans of my era, Iraq and Afghanistan, are unemployed. Of those 4 out of 5 that are currently employed, approximately 30% of them are facing employment discrimination. There is no better way for a veteran to earn a living than by running their own business. And the legislation that the senator has sponsored will allow people from Iraq and Afghanistan to start businesses in New York State to generate income for themselves and tax dollars for the state of New York. I'm very happy that the senator has proposed this, and it puts veterans on a level playing field with minorities and women in business. So thank you, Senator, for your sponsorship.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, I know it ran a little bit over, but I think it was very important. I want to thank all the veterans for coming.